She was an elite cyclist. Now she's an elite cyclist and a mum. Delighted to be joined by four-time Olympic gold winner Laura Kenny, CBE. Although I introduced you as Laura Trott earlier, I'm really sorry.
Oh, I didn't even realise.
What's it like being a new mum?
Oh, I love it, honestly. I absolutely love it. It's the best job in the world.
Being a cyclist, obviously.
Honestly, he still doesn't sleep. He's 10 months old and he still doesn't sleep. But honestly, being mum to Albie is just the best job. I absolutely love it.
OK, talk us through, because I remember the image of the three bikes.
Yeah.
That's how you made the announcement, yeah. Wasn't it? Tell us about it.
Well, it was actually Jason's mum's idea. She came out of it and she just said, oh, wouldn't it be nice if you had a little bike? So I rang my coach, because he's got children, and just said, can I borrow the little bike? Set it up, and there it was. The funny thing was, though, I remember messaging Danny King, well, Danny Rowe now, and was like, are people going to understand that? And she was like, oh, no, I'm not sure.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think we all got that. What was it like cycling while you were pregnant? Did you have to wait for a while before you could then get back on the bike? Were you still competing?
So I raced when I was 3 months pregnant with Albie. I did the Madison National Championships with Eleanor. Yeah, so that was the last race. But then after that, I didn't really feel myself for much longer, if I'm totally honest. If I did anything too hard, I just felt sick and I just wasn't really enjoying it. But I did carry on exercising throughout the whole thing. It was probably only the last 6 weeks that I really stopped, completely. And used to just swim a little bit, just to keep me kind of sane. Because, you know, you go from exercising every single day to pretty much nothing. But then afterwards, it was 6 weeks after that I actually got back on my bike. Wow. So it was quite a quick turnaround.
Wow. What sort of exercise? I remember doing a step class the day my son was due, actually.
He
wasn't born for another couple of weeks after that. But yeah. The day he was due, I did a step class. It's really important to stay physically fit, isn't it, if you always have been. Did you put much weight on?
In total, obviously, when he was still inside, I was 20 kilos heavier.
Right.
For me, quite a lot, But I just thought, I just didn't really think, if I'm totally honest. I just really wanted to enjoy my pregnancy, and that's what I felt like I did.
You enjoy being pregnant?
Until probably 2 weeks, and then no, it was awful.
How is it being an elite athlete and a mum?
Busy.
Yeah, I'm sure.
To be honest, it's a bit of a
routine.
Yeah, so I mean, we're so privileged that we've got our grandparents, like Albie's grandparents, to help. So my mum and dad come up a couple of days a week, and then Jason's parents do the same a couple of days a week. And then on the days, obviously, where we don't have help, me and Jace just make sure that we don't clash. So I'll train in the morning and then he'll train in the afternoon. And it's just about, you know, having a set plan, so knowing when the grandparents are coming round and just being really organised, and that's just the way it works.
How did you know when to go back to work, as it were?
I would say that, you know, I didn't really know. I just sort of fell into it. So initially, I'd said, I'll try and get back on the bike after 6 weeks. That's what I always sort of had in my head.
And then, because without going into too much detail, for those blokes who are watching this after, it's going to be quite hard getting on a bike when you've just given birth to a baby.
Yeah. I mean, to be honest, I didn't really think about that. I just thought, oh, it's just what I'm used to. I'll just go and do it. And honestly, it was absolutely fine. So that was 6 weeks after. And I would just say I was just riding. I wasn't training. It wasn't until the January that I actually went on an actual training camp. And that was the first week. So Albie was about 5 months old, and that was the first proper week of training that I actually did. And after that, I was like, oh, I'm ready now. Like, I'm ready to actually fully commit to this again.
Mm. Okay, I think we've got some pictures of you on your bike and when you were training. Just remind us how you got into cycling in the first place.
It was through my mum, actually. I guess my family were always really quite active. My dad used to play cricket, and then my mum got into cycling.
Great picture of you.
It was my mum chose it as a form of losing weight.
Did she?
Yeah, and that was it, really. I was 8 years old, and we just loved it.
Mm. Remind me how many medals you've won.
So I've got 4 Olympic golds. I think I've got 7. I know I should know these stats. I think I've got 7 world championship golds, and then lots of World Cups and Europeans. I think 10 European golds.
Did I read somewhere, or did I hear you say, who's that? Is that your dad that you were having a big hug with?
Yeah.
Did I read somewhere that you were going to make a clock out of all of your medals,
so
both yours and Jason?
Yeah.
What have we got?
So we've got obviously 10 Olympic golds and then 1 silver of Jason. So we need one more to make it complete. So we couldn't retire, could we?
No, you couldn't. 2 driven parents is going to be a challenge. challenge for Albie, isn't it?
Everybody says this. You know, I don't care if he doesn't do cycling. I just want him to have an active lifestyle, honestly. I just want him to... Anything, any career that he, the path that he takes, I really don't mind as long as he's driven to do it, you know, and as long as he really enjoys what he's doing. And then additionally to that, I really want him to just have an active lifestyle. I don't mind if he does football, hockey, tennis, it could be anything. I just want him to be outdoors and out in the fresh air.
Hugely important for kids to be active, isn't it?
Definitely.
And it's so easy for them to sit in front of a computer screen or the TV or whatever, watching cartoons.
Yeah, no, it is.
So you're very careful that's what's in your mind and that's what you want for Albie.
Yeah,
Albie.
I do.
And hey, if he was an Olympic world champion like you are, then that would all to the good.
You wouldn't mind.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So talk to us about training regimes now. What does that involve for both of you? Because you said you might train in the morning and Jason trains in the afternoon.
Yeah, so I mean, it can be really varied depending on what sort of point of our schedule we're in. So at the minute, I'm really sort of track heavy. I'm trying to
qualify.
So it just means spending a lot of time on the velodrome, basically. Yeah. Basically. So for us, we have to actually
How do you stay focused when you're doing that? Do you not get like a bit hypnotised by this?
No, you get used to it. You do, yeah. I mean, it's a bit like, you know how gymnasts go spinning and they say they don't get dizzy?
Yeah.
yeah, and it's a bit like that, I suppose. You have a focus point.
And have you used to train together?
Me and Jace?
Yeah.
No, not really, no, because obviously he's sprint and I'm endurance.
Yeah.
So yeah, not really. No, okay. We're pretty separate.
But presumably at the end of the season, it's a bit like whether you're a sprinter, I'm guessing, a sprinter or a middle distance runner on the track.
Yeah.
You still would have to do, you know, cross country and all that sort of stuff. So you'd have to do endurance stuff.
I do a lot of endurance. But Jace, no, not really. He doesn't really do much.
He's more of a glory boy, is he?
I mean, like, we will go on the odd road ride together. But no, we don't really. I wouldn't class it as training together.
And I want to talk to you about safety and security on the road in just a short time. But I'm really interested in still talking about what you're up to now. And as far as Sir David Brailsford is concerned, I mean, I've interviewed him a couple of times. He's quite a driven man, isn't he?
Oh, he really is driven. Yeah, he is. Obviously, he doesn't, he's not the head of British Cycling anymore. There he is. He just does Team Sky now. He's a very highly driven man. And, like, honestly, through the years, because obviously he was, the head of BC right up until, like, the end of 2012. Well, in fact, he went a bit longer than that.
British Cycling?
Oh, yeah, British Cycling, okay. Sorry. Yeah, he went a bit further than that, actually. I think he just went to Sky for 2013. But honestly, the amount of information and knowledge that he has is just so unbelievably helpful. And for somebody who, I was 20 and I went to my first Olympic Games, to have somebody so driven and so focused on a goal was really quite key to our success as a team, because you could always turn to him about anything and he'd know what to say.
Sure. I remember him talking about the suits that you would wear, and you know, a lot of the other teams adopted that subsequently, didn't they? And also he said that if it made the cyclist faster, he would have 4 millimetres shaved off each shoulder blade. Did he ever tell
me
that?
Oh, he never told me. I'm glad I never read that even before getting on the team.
So he never broached that with you.
Hello again, you're watching Sky News. Kay Meads, Laura Kenny still with me, elite athlete and mum. We obviously know your husband very well as well. And you got married, when did you get married now? It was back in 2016?
Yeah, September. So it was a month after the Games.
Really?
Yeah.
So how did you have time to plan that?
It was just a nice distraction. Like, everybody asked me this, and to be honest, it was
beautiful.
Nice.
Beautiful dress.
Oh, thanks.
Are those peonies?
Oh, no, they're roses.
Are they?
Yeah, roses, yeah.
Beautiful.
Oh, thanks. It was just, it was a distraction, one that I guess I needed. A lot of people would be like, I can't believe you would do that leading up to an Olympics.
Yeah.
But for me, it was it just took my mind off of cycling. So when I was at home, it was just wedding planning. And then when I was on the bike, it was just about racing.
And we're used to seeing you dressing up, not at least when you got your CBE.
Oh, I know. Oh, I was carrying little Albie as well at the time. That was a day. It was an absolute honour to
Princess
be there.
Princess Anne.
Yeah. Oh, and she's great as well, because obviously Princess Anne has got Zara, and so she's in the sporting world. So it was great to have a conversation, you know.
What did you say?
About sport.
What did you talk about?
She was asking whether I'd had a break of this length, because obviously I was pregnant.
Yeah.
And I hadn't actually. It was
you
the longest.
You look so nervous.
I was nervous. Honestly, I was so nervous. Like, my legs were trembling. It was terrifying.
It is your chosen profession. It can be dangerous.
Yeah, it can
talk
be.
Talk to us about car dooring. What is that?
Yeah, well, so car dooring is simply somebody not checking when they're getting out of a car and opening a car door onto a cyclist. So I'm actually, I'm joining with Addison Lee at the minute to promote an initiative, which basically is called the Addison Lean. And so it's quite literally using the hand opposite to the door that you're about to exit to lean over, to lean across and use that hand to get out of the door. Because by doing so, like, your whole body's turning and it makes you actually look and see if there's any cyclists coming. And so for me, it's about, like, if we can teach one person today the Addison Lean, we could save a cyclist from getting hit by a car.
So people open the door, haven't looked
and literally open it on a cyclist, and wow. you just crash straight into it. You haven't got time to react, like, it's too quick.
Is that a very common injury incident?
Yeah, so Addison Lee actually did some research on it, and 65% of the people they asked either knew somebody or had been car doored themselves. And 74% of that 65% actually ended up in hospital from it.
Really?
So it is really, like, the you know, if you do get hit by it, it's really quite bad. Like,
talk to me about more general safety as far as cyclists are concerned. I took part in a programme for Sky Sports a while ago where we trained for the first leg of the Tour de France, the Tour de Yorkshire.
Yeah,
do you remember that?
Yeah.
And I was terrified on the road, absolutely terrified. Not least because my feet were in cleats. It's really difficult to get out with a twist and everything if you need to quickly.
Yeah.
And there were big lorries around me. I went cycling with Boris Johnson, and he was off, and I was really quite anxious.
Yeah, I mean, I would say it's something that you really do get used to the more you do it, but I do think, I just feel like it's a 50-50 thing. I think if cyclists show cars more respect, cars will show us more respect, and vice versa. And I do think that it's really important. I mean, in Australia, they actually have a thing where you should pass the amount of a car door. I think it's a metre and a half.
Yeah, that's what I was taught.
You should give them the space, And I do think that's massive to help with cyclists, you know. And I know we get bad publicity riding two abreast, but a lot of cyclists do that because it makes the car slow down, because obviously...
bigger.
Yeah, and you're more present on the road. I mean, on the other hand, I know that there are cyclists who just don't abide by the rules of the road. I know people jump red lights, and obviously the video that came out on the news the other day with the person undertaking the horse. Things like that do really frustrate me.
We've got those, actually. So, and this horse seems, you know, not that bothered. They're a bit close, but not that bothered.
Yeah.
But then why on earth did they come up? Look at his ears, he's not happy at all. There's hardly any room there on the left-hand side of that horse, and you don't expect them to come up on the inside, which they'll do in a second. And I think that the rider does a brilliant job to keep that horse under control. There you go.
Yeah. I mean, that it's just so dangerous. And, like, honestly, I just don't know what was going through that person's head, because not only has he put the horse in danger, well, himself in danger, because it's an animal. Like, you don't know how that animal's going to react. Mm. You've put the horse in danger and you've put the rider in danger. Mm. And it is people like him who give us a bad name. You know, we have this initiative, this Addison Lean, but people won't take it seriously because of people like that, because they'll be like, oh, it's just another cyclist.
What on earth must that cyclist have been thinking?
I don't know. I mean,
are you so much in a zone that you don't even think about it?
No, you're not. No, race or no race, because I think I read somewhere that this was a race that they were in. That is not acceptable at all. Like, you cannot do that.
Would you say to those cyclists that undertook that horse?
I honestly, I would be like, what on earth was running through your mind to do that? Like, that poor woman on that horse, she must have been absolutely terrified. And I just think, I honestly just don't know what would have gone through his head, like, to go up the inside of a horse. I mean, for me personally, I wouldn't even overtake a horse close. I wait until I know it's completely clear and I overtake as far over onto the other side of the road as I physically can get, because, like I say, it's an animal. Like, it might be scared. You don't know its circumstances, do you?
It could quite easily have reared up and caused injury to itself or other people.
And to the rider also. Mm. Like, and I just think, why would you put that person in danger?
Mm. But there are, again, some cyclists, I'm not going to let you have it all your own way, there are some cyclists in London who do not abide by the rules, and as a result, again, they put themselves in danger as well. And if you are clashing with a car, it's only ever the cyclist that's going to come off worse.
Oh, definitely, yeah. I mean, yeah, you're getting hit by something that's a lot.
So, what are your top tips for city cycling?
to abide by the rules, honestly. I just think it is just key to, you have to be so aware. I think, I mean, it is a 50-50 thing in terms of, yeah, we're going to come off worse. Don't jump red lights. I mean, I think that's stupid. Even if it is a left-hand turn, I just think, no, just don't do it. And just be so aware, because obviously, like I say, you might get a car who turns left on you, but keep your head up. And you'll be able to react better to it. And yeah, I mean, there's rules for a reason. You know, there's we have to follow the same highway code as a car does. And that's exactly what we should do. And that's what I think, you know, everybody needs to do to just make the whole thing a better place. I mean, I know the government are obviously trying to help with the road infrastructure over here. I know we're trying to make it better. And that's just a massive step forward and something that I think...
Cycle superhighways.
Yeah. And I think that would be great, you know, for cyclists, because it also does take them off the road a little bit as well. And I think for me, that, like you said earlier, you felt really sort of unconfident and unsure, and I think that would help. And obviously that would also help more people get into cycling, and that's what I want to see, because it is a sport that I love so much.
And you want to get home to Albie every night, don't you?
And I want to get home to Albie, yeah.
Of course. How would you, for parents watching this afternoon, how should they get their kids involved in cycling?
Well, for me, I started at a club. So I just went down to Welling Wheelers, which is our local one. My parents took me down there, and that was it. It sort of started there. So I would say get them down to a club. You find out all the knowledge, there's all the equipment to borrow, because obviously with cycling, it can be quite expensive, like the further you go with it.
How do you start off? What sort of bike do you get? And what do you need? Obviously a helmet.
A helmet, yeah. That's all you need, helmet and a pair of shoes. That's it, literally it. Because if you do go to a club, there's bikes. Obviously, I went to a track club, so it's Velodrome, so it's a track bike. But they'll lend you a bike. You just pay to hire one for the session. And away you go. So you literally just need a pair of trainers. I actually think that they lend helmets as well. So it's just you, really.
And as far as cleats are concerned, I never got on with them.
Is there
a trick to it? I was just to think I was going to dislocate my knee.
Maybe loosen the pedal if it's that tight to get out. Because, like, my road ones...
If you don't know what cleats are, basically, a couple of times I've gone up to traffic lights and tried
just
to get my... And you just go...
Oh, it happens to the best of us.
Does it? So, yeah, I meant to do that.
Yeah, honestly, I've seen so many people do it. It's fine.
How much longer are you going to race professionally for?
I don't know. I obviously
you need those two more medals to make that clock.
So I obviously want to go to the next Olympics.
Are you on course to do that?
Oh, I mean, I don't know. You have to ask my coach that.
What do you think?
I hope so, yeah. I think this next coming season will be more of like a show of where I am and like how much work I've got to do, you know, to get back to that level. Because I did have such a long period of time out. I mean, I didn't race for a year at an international level. So, you know, I've taken quite a step back. So I think this coming season, I'll get, you know, an actual sign of where I'm at. And then I'll be able to tell then whether I think I can make it again.
Okay. Laura Kenny, it's been an absolute pleasure to meet you. Thank you so much. Big hug for Albie. Appreciate it. Laura Kenny.
Thanks.